We are really honored as the Windermere Ukulele Orchestra to get to open up for this event. The State of the Schools Learning Fair is a really unique opportunity for all the members of our community, even if you don't have students in the schools, to come and see what we're doing in the schools. It's really neat for me as a teacher to get to go and see my former students and the wonderful things that they're doing. The Windermere Ukulele Orchestra is a program at Windermere that's an after-school enrichment program that's offered to 3rd, 4th, and 5th graders. And this has been an interesting year. Parents know that I've been out for a couple of months with ankle surgery, and I would like to thank the members of the Ohio State Ukulele Club that if it hadn't been for them, I don't know if we would have been able to do it this year. So really, really appreciate it. We'd also like to thank the school board. We'd like to thank Mr. Emhoff. We'd like to thank our principal. We've had lots of support from the Windermere PTO and the Upper Arlington Education Foundation. All these wonderful groups have helped us over the years, and it's a really fun thing that I get to do in addition to being a third grade teacher. We are going to do two last songs for you, and thanks so much for coming.
Yeah. That was pretty amazing. Let's give one more round of applause to them. And thanks to their teacher, Mr. Jason Hudson, and his leadership. That was wonderful. Love it. My name is Robin Comfort, and I am president of the school board this year. I'd like to welcome you all. Thank you so much for coming. And I would also like to welcome the other members of the school board who make up a great team. I see Nancy Dries back in the corner. Nancy, could wave, please. Stacy Royer. See Stacy. Matt McClellan. Okay, hi Matt. And Carol Moore, who is vice president, working with me closely this year. We love the opportunity for parents to come and a chance for us to demonstrate what our students are doing. But we also want to give the community a chance to understand what we're doing, how we're working hard, and keeping our commitments to the school. So without further ado, I would like to introduce our superintendent, who is going to share more with us tonight about what the schools are doing.
Thanks a lot, Robin. Thanks to the members of the Board of Education, and thanks to all of you for being here tonight for our third annual State of the Schools event. As I start, I do want to say a special thank you to our school board members. It is an amazing amount of work to serve on a Board of Education, and this may shock you, but they seldom get calls from people telling them what a great job they're doing. So they spend a lot of their time, and they are happy to do that, dealing with people who have questions, and they do a wonderful job of that. But most importantly also, they really set the vision and the direction for our schools. And I just want to thank them for that, and I think they are doing a fantastic job. There are a number of special guests with us tonight, and I just wanted to take a moment and pause and thank them for being here. Whenever I do this, I realize I'm probably going to miss some people. I will apologize in advance. We were watching as people came in. So again, I wanted to thank those who are with us tonight. Wanted to start with our state representative, Mr. Jim Hughes in the back. Jim, thank you so much for being here. Also, our state senator, Stephanie Kunze. I see Stephanie right over here. Stephanie, thank you. Our city manager, Ted Staten. Ted, thank you for being here. Our new fire chief, Chief Noshinger. Where is Chief? He's right there in the back. Thank you. Our mayor and president of the council, Debbie Johnson. Debbie, thank you so much for being here. The director of the best library anywhere, right, Chris? Chris Taylor, thank you for being here. And special treat, we have our former treasurer here tonight, Marvin Founds. Marvin, I wanted to thank you for joining us. Also, I want to thank the members of the Stand Project who are here tonight. This is a community coalition who is working just to combat the devastating effects of alcohol and drug abuse, especially among our young children. So I just want to thank all the members of the Stand who are here, and just always want to say a special thanks to the city of Upper Arlington and to the library. The three of us work very, very closely together, and I think that this community is at its best when the schools and the library and the city are working close together, and it is our privilege to work with all of those groups. And I also want to thank our amazing staff. You just saw Jason here and the wonderful group from Windermere, but I'll tell you, we have an amazing staff, and I am so proud of them, and I want you to know that they are dedicated each and every day to serving the needs of our kids, and we are in their debt. So if you're a member of the staff in this school district at any level, could you just stand so we could say thank you? Don't be shy. Thank you very much. Then I also want to thank just all of you, our parents and community members. We are nearing our 100th year as a school district and a community, and as all of us know, this is an incredibly special place, and it's a special place because of our partnership and because of the way all of us work together. So I just want you to know it is an honor for all of us to serve you and your children, and we just want to thank you for all you do in our community. So as we move on, I hope you enjoyed all the slides at the beginning as you were coming in. This is just a sampling of some of the great things going on in our school district. If we were to talk about all the amazing things our students and teachers are doing, we would be here longer than you want to be here. And so we are not going to do that tonight, but we are going to pause and talk to you about a number of things that I think you'll be interested in. So this state of the schools has become a time of year that we pause and reflect upon our service to you and share with you our progress towards achieving our goals in our strategic plan. Our Board of Education feels it's very important to set goals and then to hold ourselves accountable for the achievement of those goals and to make sure our students are uniquely accomplished and prepared to serve, lead, and succeed, which is the vision of our school district. Tonight I'm going to begin by talking about our facilities process, which is a part of our efficiency goal in the strategic plan. As a reminder, we actually started our facilities process 2 years ago at our first annual State of the Schools event. And the recommendation for that facilities master plan came from a group of community members that was formed by our treasurer, Andy Geisfeld, and that group was called our Efficiency Task Force. And this was a group of UA community members who came alongside of us to look at our operations and make recommendations for how we could be more efficient. And they recommended that we begin a full-scale facilities master planning process, and we do that immediately to deal with our aging buildings. So the Board of Education accepted that recommendation from a group of community members and began a 2-year, 3-phase process to accomplish this work in collaboration with all of you as members of our community. The 3 phases of this process are the assessment phase, the options phase, and the decisions phase. And the theme of this process from our Board of Education was simply, your voice matters. Now, in the first phase, or the assessment phase of the process, the state of Ohio paid for a third-party physical assessment of all of our buildings. And that work was what was actually completed by a company that will never work in our school district. And following that assessment, the Board of Education hired its own architecture firm and a construction estimating firm to come in and validate that assessment and update that assessment. And I've said this many, many times at meetings, and I'm going to say it again tonight. As we look at our buildings, which are on average over 64 years old, there is no zero-cost option. In fact, there is no option that is not very, very expensive. We found through our first phase of the process that just to fix our buildings over the next 15 years would cost approximately $188 million. Now, during this phase of the process, the Board of Education also commissioned an educational assessment of our building, and they continued the practice of conducting an enrollment study that looks out 10 years, and we do that annually just to predict the students who are going to be coming into our district. So that was our first phase. Our second phase was the options phase. And in this phase, we asked community members and staff members to volunteer and join building teams. And these building teams were actually asked to come up with options for our buildings other than just fixing them. And so all of the options that we looked at in this phase, and this is the beauty of the process, came from our community, along with price tags. And so during that phase, we also dealt with the fact that we are growing. I will tell you that I've learned this. Many people in UA are surprised to learn that we are a growing school district. If you read the Columbus Dispatch on December 26th, there was an article, and that article demonstrated the fact that we are one of the top 10 fastest growing school districts in the entire state of Ohio. And our projections are showing us the same thing. In fact, we are out of room at all of our elementary schools except for Tremont. We are building on there now. And we are also out of room at our high school. And so we not only have physical things we have to deal with, we're also out of room. And so we dealt with all of those things in the options phase. And after hundreds of hours of volunteer work from our building teams, we developed options. We asked our community to weigh in. And then we used input from our residents who attended community meetings. Thousands of our residents took an online survey, and we conducted a telephone survey, and we used all of this data to actually recommend a master plan to our Board of Education, which is an option for each of our 9 school buildings. Our Board of Education took a couple of months to actually receive even more feedback on that recommendation, and then in December, our Board of Education approved our master plan. So then in January, earlier this month, we began our third and final phase of the process, which is the decisions phase. We began this phase by forming a group we are calling the Financial Advisory Board. They are a group of community members who have expertise in finance and construction. I often tell this story when Chris Potts and I are in community coffees. I'm in my fourth year here in UA, and I love it here. And one of the things I have learned that is true, that no matter what the area or no matter what the topic, I can promise you that one of the leading national experts lives in UA. It seems to always be true, and I love that. And so we decided, as we talk about how to deal with our buildings and how to fund them, we should tap into that expertise from our community. And that is just what we're doing with our Financial Advisory Board. So we've asked them to come alongside of us and to review both our operating needs and our facilities needs and issue findings regarding what they think we should put on the ballot in November of this year. And then in March and April, we're going to come back up and ask you what you think about what they said. It is important to know that not all of our facility needs are now, and all of these needs are not going to be able to be tackled at the same time. This is a long-term master plan, and we're going to have to deal with these issues over time. Our treasurer, Andy Geisfeld, is going to be giving you more details about that financial advisory board in just a minute. So as you can tell, this process, which is entering its third year, has been a historic effort meant to engage every possible member of our community. To date, we have had more than 5,000 touch points, which means over 5,000 instances of someone filling out a survey, attending a meeting, having a home coffee. This is fantastic, but we don't think that is enough. We need more people to get involved to fulfill the Board of Education's charge to us of making sure every voice matters. And so as we work through the third phase of the process, we need you to get involved. Here is a short video which is going to have some of our volunteers who've been involved explain to you what this process has meant to them. Karen?
I've attended as many as possible of all of the building facility meetings. So toured schools, talked about what the options could be, what issues needed to be addressed.
Been participating in the meetings. Tours through the overall schools to see how the overall facilities have been holding up over time and where the areas of maintenance are needed.
Being part of the building teams was fascinating. I mean, one of the things that I loved was the complete transparency of it, the idea of being really at the table and being able to contribute to options.
It's been very positive. It's been extremely informative. I feel like our voices have been heard.
It's been very good. I think the interesting part has been how open it's been and how inviting the school board has been to be part of the process. I also appreciate the level of rigor and planning that's been going into it and not trying to rush to a decision.
That's pretty incredible that kind of collaborative process was not only encouraged, but also that they took the time to allow that to happen.
And we still have several more months left in the planning process. So I want, if you don't hear anything else tonight, I want you to hear this. There's still time to get involved, and we want all of you to get involved in this process. We're especially going to need your feedback in March and April, because we're going to be asking you to give us feedback on what we are proposing to put on the ballot in November. And that is the time to speak up and let us know if we're on the right track. So that is going to be a critical time. So look for your emails and your mailboxes and social media that is going to give you more opportunities to get involved. And I want you to know one of the things we're also asking you to do is to sign up to host a coffee in your house. Chris Potts, our COO, who is in the back, wave Chris. Chris and I actually committed to doing 100 coffees in homes in a one-year period. And we have until May to actually fulfill that goal. We have done 55 to date. And I will tell you, March and April are going to be a great time to have a coffee in your house, because we're going to be able to talk to you about actual projects, actual numbers, and have all of the details. So even if you've already hosted a coffee, it would be a great time to have another one. I would invite you to call my office and get that scheduled. And Chris and I will be happy to be there. Right, Chris? Okay. So at this time, I'd like to introduce our treasurer and CFO, Mr. Andy Geisfeld.
Thanks, Paul, and thank you all for coming tonight. You know, tonight's one of my favorite nights to just watch what's going on in the district, to see the students, to see other projects going on over at the cafeteria, and really to hear what's going on. As Paul mentioned, we have created this financial advisory board. This board has helped us through the third phase of the facility process. And with that, we've added 10 members to our financial board, and all of them have experience in the business side, with the idea that they can really help us through this process. I can tell you we've had 2 meetings so far, and this group is a huge asset to us. I've been amazed at the questions they've asked, how they've changed some of our focus, how they've changed some of our maybe priorities when it comes to the operations side of it, and I'm only looking forward to the next several meetings as we look at the master planning process again and see what we recommend then to all of you in the March and April timeframe. Also with that, as Paul mentioned, in Upper Arlington, whenever you have a need, someone steps up. And we have all kinds of various task forces over the last several years. One of the ones was the efficiency task force that he mentioned, and we had 8 citizens jump in from the private side once again to really look at our finances, to look at how we operate. Part of the recommendation was once again to look at the future planning of our master plan, but the other one was really to look at efficiencies in the district. How can we do things differently? How can we be more efficient? How can we be more productive? And how does the private side do that? That was important to us, and that happened in January 2014. And why that was important to us was the fact that in November of 2013, you all voted a levy for us. And one of our promises was we would increase our bottom line by June of 2017 by $4.5 million. And through the implementation of efficiencies to get to that spot. But the one caveat, and a big caveat, was we could not impact students negatively. So with that, in October of 2016, we actually shared our results so far. We've actually passed the $4.5 million, and we've made $4.7 million in either cost avoidances or cost efficiencies to impact our bottom line for this year. So we made a promise, and we've kept that promise. One of the other promises we made was that we would not come back to the community for an additional operating levy for 4 years. And I'm proud to say that through the decisions of the board, the financial decisions of the board, we are right where we thought we would be 4 years ago. And we've kept that promise of not coming back to you, the community, for 4 years. We made a promise, we kept our promise. We take that very seriously when we make those promises. And lastly, one of the areas that we've really focused on is the efficiency goal, at least from my side of it. And not only the $4.5 million, but one of the other strategies we had in there was, how do we create an easy to read annual financial report? And the challenge with that, unfortunately, school finance and easy to read doesn't come together. So we really tried to work on graphs. We tried to work on just more layman's terms of how school finance works. And what we did then in last spring, we issued our first financial update. And you can get one of these on your way out or on our website. But we've really tried to make things, I guess, easily understandable on how we operate. We are in the middle of the, middle of the process of updating one for this year. But with the whole idea, again, to be as open and as transparent as we can be and find ways to meet our community. So please look at our website. We have we have a 5-year forecast on there. We have various projections. We have various efficiencies, and to see the various things we've done for the efficiencies, go onto our website and see our details, because we take those promises very seriously. So with that, I'll turn it back over to Paul, maybe.
Thanks a lot, Andy. We are really fortunate to have Andy here as our treasurer. He's got experience in the public sector, obviously, but also in the private sector, in the private sector, and he's also a graduate of this high school. So, Andy, it's great to have you, and we're thrilled that you're our treasurer. I noticed as I was standing back there that our police chief is also here. I just wanted to say thank you to Tracy Hahn for being here, and if you haven't met, we have a new police chief, a new fire chief, and they are great people, and I would encourage you just to introduce yourself tonight. During the past 2 years, we have spent a lot of time talking about our facilities process, and I understand that. And so one of the things I want to tell you tonight is that is not the most important thing going on in our district. Absolutely not the most important thing going on in our district. The most important thing happening in our district yesterday, today, and tomorrow is what happens in our classrooms each and every day. That is what our passion is. And that is what the passion of our teachers is, and that is what's most important to us. Our mission is to challenge and support every student every step of the way. And so I just want to assure you as community members that we're not taking our eye off the ball. We are keeping our focus on what matters most. So our strategic plan focuses on two areas that really directly impact our classroom, both personalization and performance. Many of you know our district has a history of being both a state and a national leader in education. We also have a history of being a center of innovation. Several years ago, an anonymous donor provided $100,000 to the Upper Arlington Education Foundation to fund something innovative in our schools. Our high school staff proposed starting what they called a research and design lab to explore and test innovative ideas and then take what works and take it to scale in the rest of the school. Now, this work is very exciting, but I think you're going to get a much better flavor for what is happening if you hear directly from our teachers and one of the students involved in this process. So, Karen, why don't we hear from one of them?
There are so many phenomenal ideas. We have brilliance everywhere in this building. The key is to now have a space where we can start to foster and support that. The R&D lab at the high school is a conceptual space for students and teachers and community members to come together and explore innovative ideas. We are doing projects that can embed both IB, environmental science, and IB business curriculums with the coffee industry and fair trade. Another aspect of the global classroom would be to really integrate the interdisciplinary approach with service-based learning. So the R&D committee has given us this year a chance and a place to really expand on that idea and what we're trying to do. We're putting together the framework to be able to allow ideas to come forth and then be supported to try to find a way to make the high school a place that students and teachers want to come together and be.
For a while, like, I felt like I wasn't having fun in school, and I didn't want my education to be that. I didn't want it to be defined by grades. I wanted it to be defined by what I learned and how I used my knowledge, how I'm gonna use it in the future.
To have a space that's dedicated to testing out, prototyping, and scaling ideas, and to have people dedicated to that cause, I think is pretty unique, particularly for this area, but in particular beyond that, on a national level.
It's really cool, like, all the teachers are uniting with the students to solidify this goal, and I think that's just really something that's really positive for the school.
They're so enthusiastic. Hopefully, as we have successes, we're going to see that blossom to even more students throughout the school.
Have I mentioned how proud I am of our staff and our students? There are great things happening in the high school and across the district, and this is just one example. But I'll tell you, this would not be possible if it weren't for the efforts of the Upper Arlington Education Foundation. This is a very special community, and one of the things that's special about it is the work that our Education Foundation does for our schools. And they are an amazing group of people, and what we do would not be possible without them. So I just want to pause at this time and ask all of the current and former trustees and directors of the Upper Arlington Education Foundation, would you just stand so we could all say thank you for what you do for our schools, please. So that's a taste of the performance goal from our strategic plan. And I also want to talk about the personalization goal from our strategic plan. One of the parts of that plan that is very innovative is that we're the first district in Central Ohio and one of the first in the state to implement a district-wide one-to-one technology program. Now, we are very excited about that, and it is great to be first because we believe it's what's best for our students. But it's not about the technology. The technology is a tool. It's a tool in the hands of amazing students and amazing teachers that really allows for more personalization of learning. But I'm not going to ask you to take my word for that. Guess what? We have another video with some of our teachers and students, and I want you to hear from them. Karen?
Having the kids have that technology at their fingertips has really been amazing.
I believe technology is transforming our classrooms in great ways.
It's been an amazing supplemental resource. It's used to augment the learning that we're already doing here.
The kids are so excited every time we get to use the robots. Every kid has an iPad and every kid can run a robot, so it's fantastic.
When we didn't have Dash and Dot, we didn't know a lot about coding. So now that we have Dash and Dot, it's fun to code them.
I feel like I've learned like how to code something, or like I figured out something that I didn't figure out before.
It's connecting them really to more real world, real life kinds of activities.
It's not a linear approach to teaching anymore. Students are able to learn however best they learn. Just in this last project alone, we were able to have the intervention specialist and the ELL teacher and all of them on board helping children at their own level.
The core is obviously remains the art making experience, but the students have access to many more resources. Now we're going through, we're publishing each step of the project. All the other students can see the thought process of everybody else in the class.
The great thing here is if we've got a question or we've got a project or there's something we want to do, we can do it right then and there.
You don't have to like go into the library and look for like research books if you're doing a research project. You can just go online or go to Schoology.
Now you can work on a Google Doc and like have all your friends on the same Google Doc.
You can be working on it at any time, which is really cool. Like you don't have to be in the same room on the same piece of paper.
The classroom, we still do similar things that we've always done in best practices, but the technology piece gets to enhance all of that in the classroom, and that's the cool part.
We're really working toward redefining the learning experience in schools, and it's a valuable tool that we have here. It's just been an amazing game changer for our students.
It never gets old. We learn something new every single time we use them. There's always a new problem to solve. There's always something new that they discover.
So you have to let me say one more time how proud I am of our students and teachers. Great things are happening for our kids each and every day. Great things are happening in your schools, and I want you to know that we are truly leading the way, and I am so proud of that. Now, whenever we talk about our one-to-one program, I like to remind everyone that we funded the implementation of this program through a reallocation of our current resources. And if you want to know more about this program or anything else going on in the school district, please visit our website and you're going to find a lot of information there about all of this and more. Now, at this point, we are at a special point of the evening because tonight we are starting a new tradition. Tonight, we will have the inaugural presentation of the newly created Dr. Robert Arkin Service and Leadership Award. The Board of Education put this in effect to honor our former board member, Dr. Arkin, who served on our board for 12 years. This award is going to be presented annually to members of our community who exemplify what Bob believed in so deeply. Service and leadership. And tonight we are presenting the first ever Dr. Robert Arkin Service and Leadership Award in memory of Bob. And so at this time I'd like to invite Carol Arkin and Robin Comfort to come forward for our first presentation of this award. Come on forward. Bob was such a special man. And Bob filled a room, didn't he? Yes, he did. He filled a room. And he loved our schools. There was no greater advocate for our students and our staff than Bob. And if he was here tonight, as proud as I am, he would be 100 times more proud than I am, because that is just the kind of man that he was. Bob had an infectious laugh. He had a sense of humor that I loved. Wasn't always appropriate, which I also loved, but just an amazing guy. He had a passion for so many things. He had a passion for baseball, didn't he? He loved to share a great meal. I also had that passion, clearly. He loved the arts. He was a professor at Ohio State. His students loved him. I loved at his memorial service, just to hear more about that side of him, Carol, when one of his colleagues spoke, I just thought that was so moving. Upper Arlington is a better place in a different place, both our community and our schools, because of Bob. And I want you to know that we are in his debt and we are in your debt, and we will never forget him. And this is a award that will go on forever to honor his memory. So Carol, thank you so much for being here. And thank you for sharing Bob with us for so many years. Thank you. It's always important to stop and say thank you, isn't it? And there are so many wonderful people in our community. And this is, I'm going to look forward to this every year, Carol, as we get to pause and thank people and remember Bob. I believe that 2017 is going to be a historic year for our schools. I believe one of the most important in our almost 100 years in existence. This fall, we're going to be taking a huge step towards securing the future of our school district for the next century. And I want to encourage everyone in our community to take the time to get involved. I'm going to say again, attend a meeting, fill out a survey, host a coffee, volunteer at a school. We need everyone to step up. We need everyone to be a part of our school district so that we can be at our best. I believe together we can make sure that our next century is even more successful than our last century. And I believe that we will look back at the year 2017 and be very proud of what all of us are going to do for our community and for our schools. And as we thought about how to end our time here, we thought, what better way than with music? And so at this point, I'm going to ask you to join me in welcoming the pride of Upper Arlington High School since 1929, the Golden Bear Marching Band. Thank you.
going to play our next tune, which is called Shout It Out Loud, which was a song we played this past fall in the marching band. We also played it down in Florida at the Wrestle Bowl just last year. Play it for you, La Vida, La Vida, all right? Viva La Vida.
Thanks to our band director, Mr. George Edge, and thank you to the marching band. They are fabulous. So at this point in the evening, we're going to ask you to take your time and enjoy the learning fair in both of our cafeterias, all the booths lining the hallways, and be sure to head all the way down to the auditorium lobby. We have something new this year. It is the Education Foundation's Gallery of Grants, including Mrs. Benton's students and their Dash and Dot robots you just saw in the video. You're going to want to take a look at that. So you can go through the school store. You can enjoy some coffee from UA Rise. You also saw in a video and help yourselves to some cookies and water. So at this point, we're actually going to follow the marching band down the hallway. Enjoy the rest of your evening. Thanks for coming tonight. And as always, go Bears.